There we go. Welcome, everyone. We are now live from Canada and New York City. Hello to all the teachers, students, and everyone else out there watching. Thank you so much for joining us today for what I think will be a most creative and inspiring hour. My name is Vanessa, and I'm based at EF Educational Tours Toronto office. We are very lucky to be joined by the amazing Carly from the Museum of Modern Art in New York City, who we'll meet in just a few minutes. But first, you know, I just wanted to say that while we're all eagerly waiting for the world to open back up to us again one day soon, it is so important for us at EF and the MoMA to find meaningful ways to bring the world to you in your classrooms. Or I know that for a lot of you, that means you're still at home, like me. And hey, we know that nothing can compare to the sights and sounds of New York City and physically standing inside the MoMA, surrounded by some of the world's most extraordinary exhibitions and collections of modern and contemporary art. But Carly will do her best to transport you there in a way that most of us don't usually see, if only for a New York minute, and give you a whole new perspective, I think. We hope that it inspires your creativity, gets you thinking a bit more deeply about what avenues you can take if you've ever dreamed of a career in art, and most importantly, visit the MoMA in New York City for yourselves one day soon. And maybe you can say hi to Carly when you're there. Well, before we get started, let me first share some quick tips about the platform that we're using today, just in case any of you aren't familiar with it. Though it seems like a few of you are, which is great. First, you'll notice that your cameras are automatically turned off and your mics are muted. You will not actually be able to enable these functions unless we do that for you. You'll also notice two buttons for chat and Q&A at the bottom of your screens. So I know some of you have already been using them, but if not, please feel free to use the chat box at any time to introduce yourselves. Let us know where you're from, how many of you might be watching together, and just chat with us if you like. If you have any questions for our expert Carly from the MoMA at any time, please type them into the Q&A box. And if you have a working microphone, this could be really fun. Please also let us know if you'd like to ask your questions live. If we do get to your question, we'll allow you to unmute yourself so that you can do so, which is super cool. My colleague Morgan over there.
Hi, everyone.
She'll be monitoring both the chat and the Q&A for us throughout our session. We should have about 10 minutes or so at the end for a Q&A, but I think that's actually enough from me, I would say. So why don't we throw it over to our expert from the MoMA. So Carly, thank you again so much for being here with us today. I know you're joining from home, maybe buried under a few feet of snow.
we are digging out, thankfully. Yeah. I know snow is no surprise to anyone in Canada. So we had a nice little blizzard on Monday, but we are slowly digging out here. Well, great. Thank you so much for the introduction, and thank you for the invitation to speak here today, Vanessa and Morgan. Before you go on mute, I just want to make sure when I share my screen here that everyone else can see it properly. So just a verbal okay from you guys, and then I'll put you back on mute if that's all right.
Yep, you're all good.
Okay, perfect. Well, thank you so much again. Hi, everyone. My name is Carly. And I'm really excited to talk to you today about the Museum of Modern Art here in New York City. Normally, we would be hosting your visit on site at the museum, but I am so glad that we can still connect virtually with you all today. Unfortunately, I can't see or hear you all, like Vanessa mentioned, but I really do hope that we can still interact. So make sure you use the chat function and the Q&A function, and I will do my best to get to your questions today. Just a quick overview of what we're going to do. I'll give you a snapshot of MoMA's history to start, just in case anyone is not familiar with the museum. And then I'll be discussing a number of different departments at the museum and what it's like to work at a major art museum in New York City, from creating exhibitions to purchasing products for our store to managing our social media accounts. So let's go ahead and get started with some background. The Museum of Modern Art actually encompasses two different museums, MoMA and MoMA PS1. So we will start with MoMA. MoMA is located in Midtown Manhattan. It's about 5 minutes south of Central Park, about 5 minutes north of Rockefeller Center, and it's about 10 minutes away from Times Square and all of the Broadway theaters. It was founded in 1929 after three women, Abby Rockefeller of that Rockefeller Center fame, Lily P. Bliss and Mary Quinn Sullivan sat down for lunch and decided that New York needed a museum that solely focused on modern art. Their intention was really to build a collection that exhibits the art of the day, which is actually a mission that we carry out even now. We started with very humble beginnings with just 8 drawings and only 1 print. And our collection has grown to hold nearly 200,000 paintings, sculptures, photographs, films, and a lot more. And in an average year, we see about 3 million visitors. Obviously, that's not the case in this particular year, but we do hope to see those 3 million back sometime soon. And in 2019, we actually opened a major expansion of the museum that increased our gallery space by 30%. So what exactly is in our collection? Modern art is a lot more than a blank canvas or just some squiggly lines. There's often that reputation of, oh, I could do that, you know. But we actually have some really amazing iconic works in our collection. We start in the 1880s, so that's why things like Vincent van Gogh's Starry Night, Claude Monet's Water Lilies, the great Andy Warhol portraits, Frida Kahlo self-portraits, Christina's World, so many more, all that makes MoMA a really perfect introduction to the world of modern art. But we have a lot more than just paintings. Some really exciting, sort of surprising things are also in our collection. We have things like a Jaguar E-type roadster. We have a helicopter from the 1940s, an F1 racing car, even the very first set of emoji that was ever created. All of those are in our collection because we have an architecture and design department. And we even have another well-known object that I will let our chief film curator explain.
MoMA was privileged in 1979 to receive an actual Oscar.
Contributing to the public's perception of motion pictures as an art form. Tonight, the Academy once again pays tribute to the museum's Department of Film for its continuing and growing accomplishments.
So why am I putting gloves on to hold a gold-plated statue? It's because it's an object in MoMA's collection at this point, and we treat all of our archival objects with great care. The winner was MoMA! Oh my god! It's Oscar! Hey man, what's up?
So yes, we do even have an Oscar. We have an Academy Award because we did a lot of film preservation and conservation work in our past. Performance art and film is an incredibly important art form for us. There are numerous spaces throughout the museum where performances actually take place. And a lot of people are surprised to learn that we have 3 movie theaters on site. We have a 100 seat, a 200 seat, and a 400 seat theater. And we are very much looking forward to opening those back up to our public, hopefully very soon. But if you've ever dreamed of watching movies for a living as you're scrolling through Netflix, you'll want to pay particular attention to this next video.
Hello, everyone. My name is La Francis Hui. I am a curator in the Department of Film at MoMA. It is a pleasure to speak to you virtually. The Department of Film maintains a holding of over 30,000 films from around the world in our permanent and steady collections. As a film curator, I work with my colleagues to acquire works and engage in preservation and restoration activities. We welcome scholars, filmmakers, film journalists, and students to conduct research in our Film Study Center. I also participate in research and publish writings to contribute to film scholarship. The general public mostly encounters our work through our year-round exhibition program. We present film series and annual festivals with works from our collections and also from other sources. In a normal year, we present about 1,000 screenings in our theaters. We recently launched our virtual cinema platform, streaming films along with filmmaker discussions. I consider it a real privilege and joy to be in inspiring conversations regularly. I am at the moment attending a Sundance Film Festival virtually, which I normally attend in person. I also usually go to festivals such as Berlin, Cannes, Toronto, and Busan. Going to festivals is a key way to survey the latest works and also connect with colleagues in my field. Watching films is the most time-consuming part of my work. Film is a time-based art form. There's no shortcut. If a film is 5 hours long, you have to spend 5 hours on it. I watched 400 plus features in 2020, and I often take notes when I watch them. If you're interested in my line of work, in addition to watching films, you have to read a lot. Film reviews and critical writings on film history and film theory. Consider film studies your academic focus, which was what I did. The film world's ecosystem is enormous. Beyond curatorial, archival, and programming work, you can consider careers in film restoration, distribution, producing, publicity, etc. Try to volunteer at film festivals and find internships within the field to gain a better understanding of the inner working of my world. Thanks for listening and good luck to you all.
So if you thought that your Netflix binge was on point during the pandemic, have you watched more than 400 movies? I know I haven't. But with all these live performances and films happening at the museum, one of the really exciting parts of working there and visiting is that you never know who you might run into. You might see St. Vincent performing in the lobby. You might come across Canada's own Ryan Reynolds answering some questions after a screening of Deadpool that we have, or Spike Lee giving a masterclass in directing. So wrapping up with MoMA, we're going to cross the river. Only two subway stops away from Museum of Modern Art is MoMA PS1 in Long Island City, Queens. We consider MoMA PS1 to be our second museum. It was founded in 1971, so it's also been around for quite some time, and it's the first nonprofit center dedicated solely to contemporary art. You may be wondering about the name MoMA PS1. In New York City, all of the public schools, public school being PS, are then attached with a number. So PS17, PS121. Our building used to be a former school, so we retained the name as a nod to the building's former use. And the big difference between MoMA PS1 and MoMA is that MoMA PS1 does not have a permanent collection. So the temporary or special exhibitions are the star of the show here. We are also known for our Young Architects program, which you see out here in the courtyard. It's often the first museum in the US where young or unestablished artists are being shown for the first time. And my personal favorite, it is home to a groundbreaking music series called Warm Up. Now, Warm Up is a long-running music program housed within our museum, and it's now going on 20 years. The aim is to elevate innovative, underrepresented voices, emerging, established, local, global, cross-genre. So if you are on the lookout for the next Lizzo or the next Cardi B or the next Solange, it's very likely that you would have found them on our stage. So that is the overview of both MoMA and PS1. I can certainly pause here if there are any questions about the museum itself, but otherwise I'm happy to just continue on and talk a bit about career paths at museums. So often people think that you have to have an art history major or you have to actually be an artist yourself to work at a museum, but that is not the case. As someone who holds a journalism degree myself. We have 58 departments in total across the two museums, and it covers everything from accounting all the way to visitor services. So today I'll talk about just a few of those areas to give you an idea of the breadth of work that's done at museum, and we'll start with curation. But before that, I'm gonna turn it over to my colleague, Sarah Suzuki, for a few words.
Hi, I'm Sarah Suzuki. I'm the Director of Curatorial Affairs at the Museum of Modern Art in New York. And I wanted to tell you a little bit about the work that curators do here at MoMA. The work of curators is really central to everything that happens at the museum, in part because a big piece of their work is caring for and ensuring the growth of our collection. Our collection of art is over 200,000 objects, and it's a way that we kind of mark history. The identification of specific works that people think are really important, that say something about the moment that we're in or the moment in which they were made, about the world or about the way artists and their ideas develop, are really at the core of what we do here at the museum. Another major piece of the work that curators do is exhibitions. When you come to the museum, I hope you'll have the opportunity to visit both our collection galleries, where you'll see displays that are really focused on the works I was just talking about, but also our temporary exhibitions. And those are opportunities to take a deep dive into the work of a single artist, into an idea or a theme, into a place in the world, a moment of time. And having been a curator for many years, I can tell you that the thing I really love so much about the work of a curator is that when it comes to making and thinking about exhibitions, every one of them, and they're often multi-year projects to get them ready for you to come and see, is really an opportunity almost to time travel, to put yourself in a different space, to think about what was happening in the artist's world at that moment, what was happening in her politics, in literature, in theater, in music, in dance, in philosophy, what was happening with her fellow artists. Really an opportunity to kind of skip around the universe in a way. It means that every day here at the museum, every day for a curator is different, depending on what someone is working on. But always driven by a passion for art, a belief in the work of artists, and a belief that art can help us see the world differently. I hope if you are in New York, you'll have a chance to come and visit us and experience the work that curators are doing for our visitors to enjoy. Thanks.
So it's different at every single museum, of course, but at MoMA, we have 6 different curatorial departments. We have architecture and design, drawings and prints, film, media and performance, painting and sculpture, and photography. And they're all unified under one umbrella of modern and contemporary art. Now, curation and conservation are 2 extremely vital departments that drives a lot of the work done elsewhere at the museum. And in this first clip that I want to show, you'll get a behind the scenes look at this conservation work that is so incredibly important, and a little bit of curation as well.
I'm in the process of removing some restoration layers that were applied in the 40s and in the mid 50s. So now 65 years later, these materials have really discolored and degraded, and they're altering the original colors of the painting. So I'm removing them to reveal the real Russo palette. So I'm doing that with this tissue and solvents. Of course, the solvents I'm using have been tested to make sure they don't affect the original. They only affect the restoration layers. When I peel it away, it brings the varnish with it. And then I use this white absorbent tissue to absorb any residue of the varnish and peel it off the surface. I mean, this has always been a favorite painting of mine in the collection, and after doing research on it and finding out that for Alfred Barr, who's one of the former director, it was one of his proudest acquisitions, I feel like it's a privilege to be involved in doing anything associated with this painting. But it's a rewarding painting to treat, because you get to see, after you're removing all this restoration, much more of the original paint, and how even Rousseau, who was a self-taught artist, was painting in innovative and interesting ways.
Is this really this big?
Yeah.
Yes.
And so this is 1-inch scale.
These look like postage stamps. They probably are.
And also, Betty, you know, we...
Early prints.
Yeah.
And then early too. So are they all mixed up so they're not...
No, so what we did was to organize them around some themes.
The theme?
So here's before, like family, early years, you're moving to your house. Here you have a number of those kind of strange creatures, lions, turtle.
And then we also picked out what we thought were key works to go on. So each of the freestanding walls has one work on each side, what we thought were some of the most important works.
I mean, what I like in that floor plan, like, there is not one way to see the show.
You have to get a
Come here, and maybe you'll skip that at first, then you'll see that, and you'll come back. So I think that idea to create some universe where people find their own way.
I just want to know what the limitations are.
No limitation.
Okay, the sky's the limit.
The sky's the limit.
So in this clip you saw at the beginning, conservation work that is incredibly important, and I'm always completely in awe of my conservation colleagues who are working with these priceless works. Here you're seeing a very glamorous process of using styrofoam and really tiny versions of works of art, which is how our curators often start mapping out their exhibitions. And here also in the clip, you see artist Betty Saar. One of the incredible benefits of working at a modern art museum is that many of the times the artists are actually still living and we can collaborate with them on everything from exhibitions to the gallery wall paint color. So that is a real treat for us. And pay attention to this because you'll actually see the finished project later on in the presentation. But all of this work is really vital in making sure that the curators have a well laid out plan. And in the next video, you'll see even more detail of how we start to move from these really tiny little models to the actual execution of exhibitions.
So we're on the second floor of former print galleries. The show is called Max Ernst Beyond Painting. It's all works from MoMA's collection, but across all the departments and mediums. So beyond painting is a phrase of Ernst's, referring to the way that he worked.
One of the reasons we have such amazing holdings of Max Ernst's work is because we began to collect him very early on. The earliest works in this show were acquired for the museum in 1935, and we've sort of kept going ever since then. And that is why we're able to tell this story of this incredibly inventive artist in such a synoptic way, just by going to our storage vaults.
I don't have those even. Yeah, move that, that way.
Oh.
Yeah, a little bit to that way, to the left. Yeah, center one to the left. I don't know if they'll have that much space in the mat, but we're testing everything. So we'll know how to lay out the walls. You know, in some museums, you put a show, the walls are already there. And so you just work with what you've got and you make it look as good as you can. But at MoMA, every time there's a new exhibition, we invent new walls for the most part for the special exhibitions. So in a way it's great because you think that you've got any idea that you want to do, you can use. But when you have limitless possibilities, that's a problem too. You know, sometimes limitations are good and they help you. But right now I'm happy that we have the chance to make them exactly the way we want to.
You look like plaster?
It's plaster, but Anna just did some reflected FTIR analysis, and it's actually most probably oil paint.
FDIR.
FTIR. That's that machine over
the
there.
Warrior.
Yeah. So I think it might be better to say oil and plaster on canvas. And it's actually, I mean, it's canvas, but it's burlap. I would say burlap, maybe.
Okay.
It's more specific. Ellen, was I correct in you were saying that now that you've taken the varnish off of birds above the forest, that there's a real similarity between the pigments?
Or I'm just, at least visually, because we haven't done analysis on this one, but just visually, this black just feels much more similar. Like they're both this very matte velvety black. And they're very close together. So, you know, it could be a material that he's
just has
around. So if we get more information about what the actual pigment is here, it might be interesting to compare.
And had you gotten to see birds above the forest without its varnish on now?
There's still a little remnant, just for a reminder. But this is how glossy the varnish was.
Wow.
So it's a pretty dramatic change.
So these are the types of things that we get really excited about, whether it's removing varnish from a particular work of art and the effort of conserving a painting and getting back to the original colors, whether it's looking at the sight lines of how a visitor will understand how you navigate an exhibition. Right now you're seeing them agonize over the color of the wall paint that will go on the gallery. So we go through all these meticulous details so you don't have to. You can just have that enjoyable museum experience when you walk through the door. So you can see it is a really comprehensive process behind the scenes. And once the curators select the works that they are going to put on view, the paint color, of course, that goes on the wall, multiple other teams have to work together to bring this whole vision to life. You'll see in the next section, as we move away from curation, we are going to move over to graphic design. So this is a little behind the scenes view of our graphic design studio with the creative team. If you hear a little traffic horns and things outside, I apologize. That's the price of living in New York City. But please let me know if that gets to be intrusive. This is a really great view of the creative team's graphic design studio. This is also the floor that I work on. So I get to see what they are cooking up on a daily basis when I'm actually at the museum. Our team works on everything from exhibition treatments to wayfinding for visitors. On the right-hand side here, you actually see some mock-ups for two exhibitions that we have on view right now. Degree Zero, Drawing at Mid-Century, and then Engineer, Agitator, Constructor. So take a close look at the Degree Zero mock-up there. Those are printed on what I imagine to be one of the largest printers you'll ever see. And on the next slide, you'll see what it actually ends up looking like. So this is the final product, which is quite different from the mock-up. Clearly we are going through an orange phase right now, but you can see the typography is really important. The placement is really important. Exhibition design is a huge part of what our graphic designers work on at the museum. And beyond exhibition design, like the others that you see here, everything from Pope L to our extremely popular Tim Burton exhibition. The team also produces what we call out-of-home assets. The left-hand corner here at the bottom, you'll see something that we worked on in partnership with the MTA. You can learn about New York's iconic subway design language while waiting on the E or the M train. So sometimes you don't even have to be at the museum to see a MoMA exhibition. They also work on all kinds of printed material for the museum, lots of digital assets as well. They handle the museum map, the typography for the museums. We have our own MoMA font that we use. They worked on the design for the tickets that you receive when you come in. And for a little more information about graphic design and what you might want to think about as you move from high school into continuing education, I'll turn it over to my colleague Damien, who you will get some more information on in terms of graphic design and art direction.
Hello, my name is Damien, and I'm an art director at the Museum of Modern Art in Midtown Manhattan. I'd normally be at work at this time, but because of COVID, I'm making this video from my home office in Brooklyn. I've been at MoMA for almost 7 years, and before working here, I worked at a large creative agency, kind of like a Mad Men, in a small studio focusing on book design. As an art director, I work with a team of graphic and digital designers, and we collaborate with almost every department within the museum. We work on basically everything you'd see when visiting, from exhibition design, advertising, publications, and printed materials, to more behind-the-scenes needs like gala invitations and fundraising proposals. My favorite part of working at MoMA is definitely working on exhibitions and publications. It's always exciting to think about how to visually explain a historical moment or an artist's career through graphic design, and every exhibition offers a new chance to push ourselves and create something new and interesting. For those interested in working as a graphic designer, I think some good advice is to always have a point of view, but never to be closed off to a single idea. It's really important to be open to new ideas and to be as collaborative as possible, which usually means putting aside your ego so the strongest ideas can come forward. And some general advice for college students is to make lots of friends in your class. Not only is it just good to be social, open, and friendly, but your colleagues will be your future connections in your professional lives. I hope that gives a little insight into what graphic designers do at MoMA and that you'll be able to visit us one day in New York City. Bye.
And I would personally note too, if you are interested in being on the creative team at MoMA, it seems like we all own that IKEA bookshelf that's in the background. So that's a good, easy entry point there. Going hand in hand with our graphic design team is the digital media team at the museum. They work on a number of initiatives, but most important, I would say, would be our website. We almost treat our website like our third museum in a way, because it enables people to connect with our collection from the comfort of their homes, which is particularly important during this moment. The website serves a lot of different purposes, and we have a team of on-site designers and IT professionals that keep it running smoothly every day. Our main site needs to serve a multitude of users. We have people who are just looking to book a time ticket or maybe become a member. We have academics who are researching our collection. We have families trying to plan things to do with their kids. Teachers trying to build out lesson plans, and the list goes on and on and on. Our website has to be really dynamic and flexible in those terms. So even a recent addition to call out, we had to be flexible in adding new health and safety policies to help people prepare for their visit under the current circumstances. So providing really clear and concise information is a top priority for our web designers across the website. Another really important use is a time capsule for the museum. This particular section of our website goes from the founding of the museum all the way through to the expansion last year, and it's called MoMA Through Time. It points out really monumental moments in our history from our inception, which turns out happened just days after the stock market crash in 1929. And to our expansion opening, of course. You can see when there were houses and cars in our garden. You can learn about a tragically destructive fire that actually happened at the museum where people had to remove works of art from the wall and person to person carry them outside. You can learn about the moments where that really iconic love sculpture that lots of people have seen in New York and Philadelphia actually originated because we commissioned the artist for a holiday card. So who knew? But I think my favorite story that I found in the MoMA Through Time archive was the fact that we once had a guard dog named Don. He was hired after a very highly publicized theft at the Brooklyn Museum. However, he was not very effective After a year, he had to be retrained because he was just too friendly. Yeah, classic Don. So this is a really great example of how the digital media team works together to create a really important asset for the museum digitally that really serves as an interesting capsule of our overall history. And beyond history, we continue to create new content that our website is host to, in particular, a publication called Magazine.
You have this kind of metamorphosis going into the world of trade.
Seems dramatic to me. Oh, I think it's great.
When something appears that shouldn't be there.
Goodness gracious.
Something very beautiful and strong.
This is something I've never noticed before, and it's pretty, pretty...
So now you are all here to hear me talk about art.
Hey, Bruno!
Oh my god! It's Oscar!
Boom, that's live!
So Magazine is our online publication of features, videos, interviews, playlists. We do have our own Spotify account, and in fact, the music you were listening to before the webinar started today was drawn from one of our playlists, and so, so much more. Our team of copywriters and editors publish new content daily, and the MoMA film crew that we have on site shoots and edits completely on site as well. So if there are content creators watching this, or you know, any blog writers or people working on their social media following, TikTok creators, any of that, these are transferable skills for a career at museums. So please keep it up. And if you're not into content creation and you prefer shopping, we actually have some career opportunities here as well. With our online and our offline components, our retail division is actually a really important part of the museum's overall business. All of the purchases at MoMA actually fund our museum programming. And unlike a typical souvenir shop, our curators actually have to approve every item before it hits the shelves. And that's everything. Even you know, the postcards and the magnets, all the way up to the higher end items. Our team is really incredible. The product developers work with a number of independent designers, but they also have really great collaborations with brands like Nike, Champion, Vans, Sony, Uniqlo, our own New York Yankees, just to name a few. And we have a team of about 12 merchants who in a normal moment would actually be traveling the globe to find all of these interesting new and unique products. And they're looking for everything. Personal accessories, you know, watches, home items, tech, games, stationery. They visit trade shows. They meet with artists and designers. They are constantly scouring crowdfunding sites and social media to make sure that we are finding those really innovative examples of good design. And we also have locations outside of New York City. We have a few stores elsewhere in the world. Just opened a store in Hong Kong, and we also have a store in Japan, and all of this helps extend the MoMA brand into these international markets. And my colleague Alex Glazer will share a little bit more insight into working in the museum retail world.
Hi, my name is Alex Glazer, and I am a buyer and product developer for MoMA Design Store, the Museum of Modern Art's retail division. What that means is that I, along with my amazing colleagues in retail, and with the help, guidance, and oversight from curatorial departments throughout the museum, select and develop the products we sell. That's everything from a lamp, to jewelry, to a Champion hoodie that says MoMA across the chest. we hope to give to museum goers, to art lovers, art students, design connoisseurs. We hope to provide that really physical and tangible memento of someone's experience at the museum and for their love of art and design. I feel incredibly lucky to have this job. When I applied to be an intern at MoMA 11 years ago, it was a career I did not know existed. I studied sculpture in college, never really thought I would have my own art practice, wasn't particularly interested in that, but knew I wanted to work in a creative space and possibly a museum. I feel as though there's some version of fate that brought me into the retail and buying side of things. So if I can give any advice, it's just to be open to kinds of jobs you didn't know existed, be open to trying something a little different than what you think you might want, because you never know where that experience can lead. I think that a lot of things right now are really uncertain and we should ride that wave. So I wish you all good luck and have a great day.
So now that our galleries are full of all of these amazing things to see and our stores are full of all of these incredible products, how do we actually get people through our doors? And this is my area of expertise. So through a combination of advertising, marketing, and tourism initiatives, we make sure that MoMA is visible to locals and visitors alike, both in the streets and in their Instagram feed. So with graphic design, as we already talked about, we work on print and digital placements like these ads that you might see in a subway station. And we like to get really creative, sometimes splashing a work of art across all three panels, sometimes breaking it up a little bit. So we have a lot of options in the digital sphere. We even follow you onto the train itself with more print-based advertising. Sometimes when you get out of the subway and you see a bus pass by, we've got you covered there too. Yes, we still advertise in newspapers from time to time. And sometimes we even do something a little unexpected, like putting up a mural on the side of a building. But my particular area of expertise is tourism marketing. Which targets all domestic and international tourists. So basically anyone who lives outside of the 50-mile radius of New York City is my market. So it's just a small space. I'm the sole person at the museum who is dedicated to this specific type of work, yet tourists actually make up around 60% or even more than 60% of our annual visitation each year. Some of the work that I do, very similar to the retail team, in a normal year, I would travel the world to encourage visitation to MoMA. I would be training companies who are selling trips to New York City on what MoMA has to offer. I work on partnerships with travel and marketing companies to make sure MoMA is always top of mind when planning a visit. And a big distinction between a lot of the material that I create versus some of my colleagues, unlike focusing on a particular special exhibition or program, I make sure that my work is much more broad. So I'm targeting collection highlights, things that people might not realize we have in the collection that are visitor favorites, or information for first-time visitors. And we use all of this great information that we have, the feedback that we get from visitors, to really hone in on our message. All of our sales and marketing material is translated into 9 different languages because foreign visitation is really, really important to us. So for example, here on the left-hand side, we are targeting Brazilians with this particular asset because one, we know Brazilians like to shop, so we feature the MoMA design store, and they're also really big fans of the modern Brazilian artist Tarsila, featured here. Our Chinese visitors are very, very interested in our post-impressionist collection, so we feature things like Monet, Cezanne, lots of things like that. And even specific events resonate with certain international markets, like South Korea, for instance. One example being our Q&A with the director and some of the actors from the movie Parasite. So we really rely on all of these gathered information to make sure that we're meeting people where they are. And, you know, as a nonprofit organization, we try to be creative from time to time. So we will never turn down free advertising, particularly when it's on primetime television from what is arguably the biggest band in the world right now.
Hey, shop. Yeah, that's how you shop. I love MoMA Museum.
So a big thank you to BTS for that shout out. The last area of work I'm going to cover today as we start to wind down here is social media. Certainly, I would imagine most everyone joining us today is on at least one or two different platforms. And as museums, you know, we are increasingly relying on digital content to connect with our audiences, particularly right now. Social media is a key part of that whole communication plan. So we have a large following across a number of different platforms, which I'll talk about. And each platform has a slightly different purpose. So with our 2.2 million fans on Facebook, this skews toward an older audience, which should come as no surprise to anyone listening today. We've found in particular that this is a great option for sharing more event-related content versus some of the other platforms. Now, our tone on Twitter with our 5.3 million followers there is much different from Facebook. For instance, we actually had to close the museum on Monday due to the snowstorm that came through. But we were able to take advantage of it by having a museum snowball fight online with other museums from around the world. And we definitely don't shy away from memes. We certainly saw our share of them after the inauguration with Bernie Sanders. Here you see him with Marina Abramović and The Artist is Present. He was embedded by someone into our classic Starry Night. And we even spotted him out in the field in Christina's World. So this definitely takes a lighter tone than our Facebook account. And I would say with Instagram and our 5.3 million followers over there, I'm not biased, but I would say that this is maybe our favorite platform overall because Instagram just really lends itself well to highly visual posts and engaging stories, which is great for museums. We use stories in particular as a great way to give people an idea of what's going on digitally and sometimes even in person throughout the week. But we also use stories to really drill in to a particular exhibition sometimes. Or what we like to do is take the approach of drilling into a particular work of art and giving people just a broader depth of information than they would have likely gotten otherwise. And not to be overlooked, we also have two accounts on our platforms, Weibo and WeChat. These are two extremely large social media platforms, mostly used by a Chinese audience. We want to make sure that we are planning content specifically for them, but we also translate a lot of our existing content because oftentimes Chinese residents cannot access any of the content that we share on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, or YouTube. Most importantly, though, we want to make sure everything's fully translated. And this just generally helps us continue our goal of being an incredibly accessible, educationally driven institution, even when travel is on hold at the moment. So to wrap up all of these threads before we open it up for Q&A, I wanted to leave you with just one more video. I mentioned before that the museum opened our major expansion in late 2019, and this video shows some of the final stages of preparation before we could reopen our doors. While I touched on just a few departments here today, here you'll see a few more. Couldn't get to all 58, unfortunately. But you can see that we all work together sharing this common goal of working to share this collection of modern and contemporary art with the world.
So we're gonna start with the rotor blades. Oh my God.
Nice.
Did you see the big dome? Look. Wow.
All right. I think a legit 14 is okay, don't you?
I like that. Who's it then, I wonder? Oh, yeah. There's a big mural. Yeah, we were just planning that.
So this is the finished product.
Say that.
What do you think?
Looks good.
I think so, too.
Looks good.
A clip that you didn't see here was the team actually reframing Starry Night. I couldn't show everything because we just didn't have the time, but this whole series lives on YouTube called At the Museum. There's two whole seasons, so that should satisfy your binging purposes. But it is a really interesting process, and I can't imagine what it would be like to have to reframe and actually touch Starry Night. It makes me so nervous every time I watch it. But overall, I think you can see that it just takes a lot of people to keep a museum running. There are so many entry points into the world of working at museums, and I hope this gave you maybe a broader idea of the type of work available in the creative field. And I want to personally thank you all for your time and attention today. I know that I would have preferred to have talked to you in person. So I hope that we can welcome you to New York and the Museum of Modern Art sometime soon. And I think we do have some time left. So I'm going to stop sharing my screen now, and I'll turn it back to the EF team to see if there are any questions I can answer.
I just have to say, I don't think I ever realized how many different kinds of careers you could choose, career paths you could choose to work at a museum. So if you have a passion for art, but you just happen to be a really good writer, there's a place for you there too. That's so cool, right? That's I'm sure all the teachers out there are getting excited about, you know, that idea with their students too. So I guess we have a few minutes for questions. Morgan, do you want to go to the Q&A and see what we've got?
Yeah, for sure. So there is a few questions here. The first one was, what is the difference between art and modern art?
Oh, that's a very, very good question. It's often certainly divided in terms of when modern art starts. It is very time-based. So depending on who you ask, sometimes it's considered to be, in the mid-1800s. Sometimes people say it's in the 1900s. It really depends on who you ask. MoMA's definition is that modern art starts in the 1880s.
Awesome, okay, thank you. There was a few questions about the fire that you mentioned that happened at the museum. Is it known how it was started, and did all of the paintings and art get out of the museum?
We do know how it started. I will actually follow up with the group because I want to make sure that we get to a number of other questions. So we do know how it was started, and unfortunately some paintings were actually lost in the fire. But there is an extended article about it in the MoMA Through Time capsule that I mentioned. So I'll follow up with that link. So when we message all the participants today, you can read in more detail about that.
Awesome. Okay, thank you. And we still have some more time. So another one is, why did they want to make the Museum of Modern Art in the first place?
That's a great question. So those three wonderful forward-thinking women who had that lunch together, they realized that the artists of their time were not really being represented in museums. At the time, it was really a lot of historical art that was being shown. The Metropolitan Museum of Art is, of course, another wonderful New York City museum that has a really broad historical scope, but they really weren't supporting the artists like Cézanne or Van Gogh or Rousseau, some of the ones who were creating at that particular period of time, and they saw a need to really support those artists, and that's really the idea of how the Museum of Modern Art came to be.
Awesome.
How many students out there watching are hoping for a career in art or at a museum one day? You can type that in the chat. But I actually have a question for you, Carly, as we come to the end. I see some people are saying yes, so that's good to see. I know that there's a lot of teachers and students that are watching, and I know that they're dreaming of visiting the MoMA in person one day soon. But what advice would you give them before going? How should they prepare themselves? What can they, you know, how to prepare themselves for that experience?
Yeah, I think my colleague Alex Glazer had some really great advice in there about just thinking about things a little bit more broadly. From my personal experience, you know, I have a journalism degree, but I knew that I wanted to work in a creative field in some way. So I didn't necessarily narrow myself down to museums in particular. I wanted to kind of open up my options in terms of art. You know, I've had a lot of luck. I've been able to work with theater. I've been able to work with a dance company. I've also worked at the Met. So I just had a broader range of experiences. So I would just say to open your opportunities up. Broaden your opportunities, consider an internship that you in a different field that you might not have thought about before. Just keep things a little open right now. So keep yourself open to those opportunities.
Wonderful. We're getting some really great comments, and people are had a lot of fun listening to everything you had to say, Carly. I think it was really unique. You know, it's not just a museum tour that we did today. We took a tour behind the scenes to learn more about what it's like to actually work at the museum and think about, you know, your own career path and how it can take so many different directions and still be able to satisfy like those passions that you have. Anyways, that was really cool.
Yeah, of course. I can like rapid, I'm just glancing through the Q&A myself, so I can rapid fire answer a few of these.
Yeah, okay.
Where in the world is MoMA located? It is in New York City, right in Midtown Manhattan. We are called MoMA because it is Museum of Modern Art. So that's what that stands for. In terms of the best part about working at the museum, I get to be in the galleries every day. So obviously not right now, I'm at home, but if ever I need to take a quick lunch break, you know, I can pop into the galleries, which is really phenomenal. I did want to answer a question. The museum did not burn down in its entirety. I did see that. We did not have to rebuild the building. It was minor areas that were burned and affected by the fire. So we didn't have to build from scratch. Let me see.
I think maybe we could do one more anything else.
Let's see. Sorry. I'm quickly trying to find one.
There was one that said, how does the work get to the museum?
Sure. So we have a number of works that are actually in our collection that we own. We do have a storage facility I won't tell you exactly where it is. So we don't have a guard dog anymore. So I want to deter any ideas of theft here. But we do have a storage facility. But the idea of our collection is to make sure that things are not kept in storage all the time. Our philosophy is to constantly rotate our collection. So there's always something new to see every time you come back to the museum, because things should not be kept in storage. Things should be on view for the general public. So it is a combination of storing things on site, keeping things actually on view in the galleries themselves, and then in our storage facility as well.
Wow.
And I know that there are a lot of other questions in here. I'm happy to take a look at these afterward and follow up with anyone who I didn't get to.
Well, I think that's a good place to stop because I know it is just after one now. But I have to say thanks to everyone for asking all those really thoughtful questions to Carly and for being here and learning alongside us. And hey, if you want to learn more about how EF can help you get to you and your students to the MoMA in New York City one day soon, look out for an email from us tomorrow. We'll actually be sharing a link to this recording of this session and other links to help you learn more. And of course, browse through all of EF's educational tours that visit New York City. And if you have time, please make sure to share your feedback with us by filling out the survey that you'll see when you exit. Carly, thank you again so much for everything that you've shared with us today, for spending your time with us. It's been absolutely amazing to get that peek behind the curtain that we don't normally get to see. And thanks to all of you for participating and watching. I really do hope to get to see you again soon at our next virtual events. But for now, we'll have to say farewell and goodbye. But thanks so much, everyone. Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye, everyone.
I'll say goodbye to all my sorrow, and by tomorrow I'll be on my way. I guess the Lord must be in New York City. I'm so tired of getting nowhere, seeing my prayers gone unanswered. I guess the Lord must be in New York City. At your back door, ain't it wonderful to be where I've always wanted to be? For the first time, I'll breathe free.